Hi. A lot of questions have been floating around for me.
Most of them answered?
Yes, but then new ones float up. One of them, why do I shake? And I notice I shake more when I'm around people. I really shake when I come to these events.
What do you think?
I think I'm resisting energy. I think there's a lot of energy moving through me, and I'm not able to allow it all.
Well, that is certainly the case. When Esther first began receiving us, and Jerry was summoning more of us through her than she was really ready for, her body did a lot of quivering and shaking. She was sitting and sort of hanging onto a chair for dear life. She felt like she had her toe stuck in a light socket. And her feet were sort of kicking about. He has a video of it that, as long as Esther's alive, you'll never see. Or shortly thereafter, Jerry won't be alive. And that is what that means. In other words, summoning more energy. But the reason we ask you what you think about it is because it's also what happens when you are aware of others' attention upon you and you don't trust what the outcome of their judgment would be.
That feels true.
And that it feels more like that than the other. In other words, you are often up to speed with your energy, and you know how to do that. Mm-hmm. But when you describe it as when you're around other people, mm-hmm. that really is telling that you don't trust how they will feel about you. And you know what? You can't trust how they're going to feel about you. You can't count on them approving of you or liking you. And so you're not out of line to doubt that they're going to love you, because most of them aren't interested in you at all, and and many of them are biased in a way that wouldn't serve you. But we're just sort of really pleading a case to you to help you to finally get to the place where you don't give a rip what they think, because they're flaky. You cannot control their perspective, and so you cannot trust that the perspective of you is ever going to be valid. But the perspective that you can trust is this perspective of Source. And as you tune yourself more to the perspective of Source, you care less and less and less what anybody else thinks. Esther discovered this firsthand, because when Abraham began flowing through her at Jerry's request, there has never been someone who wanted to know more than Jerry. He was and is the question asker of the world. And mm-hmm. Esther has always seen herself as a sort of facilitator. She was his secretary. After they were married, she saw herself as someone he would have great idea, and she would find a way to implement it. Even today, that's the way that it happens. He thinks up great stuff, and Esther figures out how to make it happen. Fortunately, he has many other people helping figure out how to make it happen now, so it takes many to keep up with Jerry's ideas. He's got one a minute or more coming up. But then what Esther began to notice is that the more she facilitated, the more ideas he would come up with, until she was really busy just trying to keep up with his ideas. So then it comes around to recognizing that what you're really wanting to do is concentrate on coming into alignment with who you really are. In other words, Esther, because of Jerry's asking, actually was willing to put herself in a situation like this, which from Esther's point of view was not something that she ever thought she would do or ever wanted to do. She did not like the idea of being weird in front of people. And okay. Especially yeah. In the days that this began, it was weirder then than it is now. It's becoming more accepted, but it was weird, and Esther was not all that happy about it. And she would sit in readiness while Jerry was sort of preparing you for what was to come, and she was thinking thoughts like, how did I get myself into this? And this is another fine mess you've gotten me into. And And she was sweating bullets much of the time. But the moment that she would hit the stage and relax, as she always does, clinging to the platform or to the podium and bringing herself through the process that she's learned of breathing and relaxing and allowing, almost instantaneously, she would release those thoughts of concern and she would go into the vortex, even though those were not the words that we were offering in those days, and she would feel a calm and a clarity flow through her. And from that moment on, as Abraham flowed through her, it was a wonderful experience. And it wasn't until segment of refreshment that her nervousness would come back. But after a while, Esther began to accept that she could go to what she was calling Abraham for that security and well-being, for that sense of well-being, and she was leaving everyone else out of the equation, you see, until in time. Now she feels no nervousness whatsoever because we have finally, over all of these years, convinced her not to give a rip what any of you think. And there is plenty that is offered through emails and through letters. There are many people who do not approve when some of the book reviews that are written. In other words, they think this is just madness, and what in the world does Esther think she's doing? And there are those who don't believe that she's doing it at all, and those that don't like what she's doing if they do believe that she's doing what she's doing. In other words, there are endless, endless, endless opinions. And Esther and you, neither one of you can trust that those who are viewing you will ever be kind, because many people stand outside the vortex and beat themselves up and use you or Esther as their reason for beating themselves up. So finally you come to the place where you just leave all of them out of the equation and you attune to who you are. And when you tune to who you are, the more acclimated to this high-flying energy you are, the less you shake and the more confident you are.
So to be willing to be what my weird self and not care what anyone else thinks, just kind of I don't.
Yes, and you and Abraham would do well to no longer refer to it as weird, because it isn't. This is where it's at. This alignment is where it's at. This is what's normal. This is what you're reaching for. This is who you were before you were born. This is who you have become. This is your natural state of being. This is where it's at. The other is what is weird. So you're right when you say, so this quivering is my indicator that I'm not quite up to speed with who I am. And we say, yes, that's a good indicator of not being quite up to speed with who you are. But if you weren't making an effort to get up to speed, you wouldn't be quivering. We'd far rather see you quiver.
I didn't catch that, but I'll just listen to the tape.
Well, we'll say it again because we want you to hear it. If you had not become, and if you were not in the process of making an effort to get up to speed with it, there wouldn't be any quivering. And we think that it is far better to, in other words, there are a lot of people who, the analogy that we offer is that if your car is going 100 miles an hour and you hit a tree, it's a bigger problem than if your car is going 5 miles an hour. But we don't want you to slow your car down. Just bang into some trees until you get this figured out. That's really what we're saying.